What's going on, all my healthcare brothers and sisters? I hope that you're having a wonderful day. We are continuing on based on our previous video. If you haven't already watched it on fluid movement, I highly suggest you go back and review it again before you watch these videos. But today we're going to be breaking down isotonic solutions when it comes to fluid movement. So in order to understand fluid movement, we really have to understand a solution's tonicity. So tonicity is measured as the effective osmotic pressure gradient, that is the water potential of two solutions separated by a semipermeable cell membrane. So concentrations of solutes are dissolved in a solution which determines the direction and extent of diffusion. So fluid tonicity is the comparison of IV fluids to our blood plasma. So, if we have an IV fluid that is less concentrated than our blood plasma, then we have a hypotonic solution, less than 250. If we have an IV fluid that is a similar concentration to blood plasma, then we have an isotonic solution. That's usually between 250 and 295. And lastly, if the IV fluid is more concentrated than our blood plasma, then we have a hypertonic solution that is greater than 295. Let's begin by talking about our isotonic solutions. So the solution on both sides of a selectively permeable membrane have established equilibrium or are equal in solute concentrations, thus making them isotonic. So the concentration of isotonic solutions is similar to that osmolality of blood. So they have equal osmotic pressure, thus not having any fluid shifts occurring inside or outside of the cell. So a normal osmolality is between 270 to 295 when it comes to isotonic solutions. So some examples of isotonic solutions include normal saline. They have an osmolality of 308. Lactated Ringer's has sodium chloride, sodium lactate, potassium chloride, and calcium chloride in water. That's how we get our lactated Ringer's. They have an osmolality of 273, but it's really important to note when you're giving these to our patients is that this particular bag, unlike our normal saline, does not only contain sodium. It also has potassium chloride, which can cause hyperkalemia if we have a patient who is experiencing some kind of renal impairment. So it's really important to know that. Also, sodium lactate will convert bicarb in the body by helping treat metabolic acidosis because the bicarb can help buffer those acids. So it makes the body more alkaline when we have a metabolic acidosis. We never want to give this medication to our liver impaired patients because the liver is what's needed to metabolize that lactate. And if the liver is not working appropriately, it's not going to be able to. We've also got 5% dextrose in water, also known as D5W, but it's only isotonic when it's inside the bag. Once the solution enters the bloodstream, that dextrose component, that sugar component, is used up as energy by the body, so the only thing that we're left with really is water, thus making it a hypotonic solution once it gets inside the body. While it's in the bag, it has an osmolality of 252. And lastly, we have our colloids, which are our blood products, such as our red blood cells, our fresh frozen plasma, as well as our albumin. So again, we're going to be looking at fluid shifts when it comes to isotonic solutions. We know that we have an osmolality between 250 and 375, so fluid shifts really aren't going to occur, so this is really beneficial when we need an increase in extracellular fluids, such as with our hypovolemia patients. When it comes to the cells remain the same. There really isn't a difference because, again, the osmolality is the same as our blood products. So what are some indications and why would we give isotonic solutions? So we want to have an increase in intravascular volume, whether it is from dehydration, blood loss from either a traumatic injury, hemorrhage, or surgery. If they do have some kind of blood loss, we're most likely giving blood products and not any kind of intravenous IV fluids. Fluid resuscitation when it comes to our sepsis patients. As you know, with our sepsis bundle, we give 30 mLs per kilogram of isotonic solutions. That would be fluid resuscitation for those patients, as well as other fluid losses. If we have a patient that's vomiting or having massive amounts of diarrhea, this is a good medication that we can give in order to maintain fluid balance, specifically in our intravascular volumes. Hydration, if a patient is NPO for some reason, either because they have an upcoming surgery or they are unable to swallow for some reason, you know, this is also another form of maintenance fluid that we can give to help hydrate our patients. Contraindications, when it comes to isotonic solutions, only normal saline with blood products. If you do something other than normal saline when it comes to our blood products, it can actually damage the blood product. So you want to make sure that you're hanging that 250 normal saline bag when you're giving your blood products. Also, we have to use caution when we're giving isotonic solutions to our heart failure and hypertensive patients, because it can lead to fluid overload if we're giving too much volume too fast. So we have to kind of find the right balance in order to maintain that intravascular volume. And lastly, metabolic alkalosis with our lactated ringers. So lactated ringers, like we talked about before, converts bicarb in our blood, causing metabolic alkalosis if we're not reviewing our ABGs appropriately. So I highly recommend that you check out my video on metabolic alkalosis for further understanding of how lactated ringers can affect arterial blood gases. And I'm gonna leave a link up here in the corner. So nursing considerations when it comes to isotonic solutions, like we talked about before, you really want to monitor for fluid overload. You're going to have bounding pulses, high blood pressure. You're going to start to see that jugular vein distension in the neck. You can even hear crackles inside the lungs when the fluid reaches the lungs and starts building up there. You could have massive edema, as well as a decrease in SpO2, like we talked about before. With our acute respiratory distress syndrome, it also occurs even with just normal lungs that are fluid overloaded. As that fluid buildup begins to pile up in the lungs, it really limits that oxygenation diffusion from occurring. So you're going to see an increase, you're going to see a decrease initially in your oxygenation and your CO2, because with our CO2, that partial pressure can actually diffuse through that water initially, but as that fluid continuously builds up, you're going to have that decrease in oxygenation and that decrease of CO2. So initially, you're going to see a decrease in your oxygen and just a normal CO2 level, because it can still perfuse. And then as that fluid overload continues to occur, it's unable to push that CO2 out. So that CO2 starts to accumulate in your system, leading to a decrease in that oxygenation, as well as an increase in our CO2. I hope that this video was helpful for you in passing your nursing exams like a boss. If you have any questions, please feel free to leave them down below. I love answering your questions. Make sure that you follow me on my social media. I'm on Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter, as well as here on YouTube. Make sure that you subscribe, as well as like this video. I also have a website at www.nursechung.com, where I will have NCLEX-style questions, as well as additional resources with each of my videos. So make sure that you check that out. But until next time, I hope that you're having a wonderful day, and I will speak with you all again soon. Bye!